everybody knows who they're here for, right? Or do you need a... Well, I have to, you know, he is an Englishman. We have to do a proper English introduction, so. Paul McGann has had a film, theater, and television career spanning 30 years. But let's face it, we all know him as the Eighth Doctor, right? A little thing, what, the Day of the Doctor? He finally regenerated 17 years later. About time. So, he will be most certainly glad to tell you if his father was loaded, he would ask him for money. Please welcome Mr. Paul McGann.
I definitely
don't have a good side.
Hey, folks.
What are you hearing?
That's nice.
There we are.
We good?
You're going to stay there?
That's what they tell me.
It's a bit lonely up here.
I mean, I'll be glad to sit next to you. It's your choice.
Well, yeah, come on.
Oh, absolutely.
It's nice. Is it really early, or is it just me?
It's quite
early. Is it because I just got off a plane?
Sure, the lights go on.
Yeah. It has got that casino lighting, hasn't it? That's cool.
Mood lighting.
That 3 a.m. lighting. Keep gambling.
Absolutely. So, get started with a question that some of our people may not know. That you initially turned down the role of the Doctor.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. What was, I mean, it's the Doctor.
Yeah, I know that. I know that. I knew that then. No, I tried to keep him, that's Phil Siegel, at arm's length, which I managed to do for maybe about 6 months. Really because I just didn't, I thought he was nuts. I thought, why is he chasing me to do it? At that time, a little bit of context. We're talking now, probably half of you weren't even alive then, but this is 94. We, back on that damp rock that I come from, people began to start hearing rumors, you know, that the Doctor was going to come back, make a comeback. And there were kind of names attached to the rumors that some of them were pretty plausible. I remember who played Mr. Bean? Rowan Atkinson.
Yes.
Nice conjunction. You could picture it. I mean, within, you know, if you remember what the Doctor used to be like, as, at least as I remember what he was like, particularly McCoy's version, you could say, oh yeah, I could see there. Eric Idle, that was another name that was mentioned. Yeah, but you know, you could see it. And then I had this guy calling me up and saying, come and read for it. And I just thought, well, that's not me. I don't do that. I am not a comedian. And anyway, so I did. I tried to keep him at arm's length for a few months, but it didn't work.
Well, we're glad you lost that battle. Most
so am I. But I didn't know that he'd seen. I've got three brothers, all actors, and in those days, we used to work together. In fact, we used to fill in for each other back in the old days, because no one could tell the difference. No one could tell us apart. Yeah, we could do that. It was a time, you know, where I could do a day for Mark, or he could do a day for me, if I couldn't make it, kind of thing. But we were in 94, we were in a BBC film together, a series that we'd taken to the BBC. And it was a Victorian era famine drama set in Ireland. And I played the priest. I wish I had a picture to show you, but you know, in this black frock coat, my hair was long. And unbeknownst to me, Siegel, somewhere either in Britain or North America, saw this thing and said, "That's my guy, that's the kid I want to say I want for my Doctor, because I look like the Doctor." And that's how it had happened. I didn't know. So anyway, but I'm glad too. I'm glad he found me.
Absolutely.
He wore me down. Which he did. But you know, a nice postscript. He couldn't tell me and my brother Mark apart. so he didn't know which one it was. So we both had to audition for it.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, we both read for the role. In fact, you can still see the two auditions on YouTube. And I'm convinced, yeah, you can now, and I'm convinced that he got marking because he didn't know, he couldn't tell us apart. Yeah, seriously.
So I'm sure people didn't come to hear me ask questions, so I'm here, they have their own questions, correct? Everybody has questions for the doctor?
Yeah, come on.
Oh, everybody is shy? Yes. Yes, please.
Were you surprised when you got the call for the people for the recent one?
Well, for the short, was I surprised to get the call again?
Yeah.
Yeah, really, yeah, aww. I was surprised. Yeah, because you don't, I probably around, by the time that the series came back in with Eccleston in 2004 or 2005, part of me kind of hoped perhaps that the phone would ring then and somehow I might be involved. Then when I wasn't, and then when I wasn't, you know, for 10 more years, I kind of gave up. So yeah, I was surprised. I was surprised, but pleasantly surprised. And I was with Colin and McCoy and Peter Davidson. We were on tour in Australia. And that's when I got the call. Stephen Moffat called then. But I couldn't tell them, I couldn't tell the other guys. It was kind of nice, it was kind of nice and weird, but that kind of secretiveness began then. So I kind of got off the phone, and he made me say, yes, Moffat, this is. And it was only going to be 3 weeks hence, you know, he said, if you're going to do it, let's just do it. But don't tell the others. So even all that stuff, you know, that five-ish doctors thing, I felt lame because, you know, I'm having to pretend that I don't know. But then, you know, I was lucky because what superseded my secrecy was, of course, was Tom Baker. He didn't tell them either that he was going to be in the 50th. So their anger with him was a lot greater. I got away with it. Yeah.
Yes, right here.
Yeah, well, yeah, you heard right. I let it slip, I think, on one of the panels. But it's true. I mean, it's true in the sense that we've already begun to sort of shoot little things. But it's very opportunistic. You know, we have to be at the same place. There was a show, I think, about 6 months ago somewhere in the USA, and Peter was there. I was with Colin McCoy. The four of us were here. And he said, well, come on, we'll shoot something now. So we did. But by the nature of it, it's probably going to take a couple of years to make something long enough. So, but watch this space. Yeah, we're definitely doing another one. And I know as well that the BBC themselves are interested in backing him to do it, which is great. You know, they should be. So they should be. I happen to think it was actually the best thing out on that weekend. You know, what I mean is it had the, for me, it had the spirit. You know. It was actually better than the 50th film itself. In its way, it was. It had it. Anyway, there we are. Yeah, Lies at the End was good.
Okay, this is a two-parter. Your favorite Doctor Who monster in bow tie or ties?
Bow tie or ties. It's got to be bow ties, you know what? The tie. There's no one in the room with a tie. The tie is the strangest affectation. Of course, like a lot of kids, I had to wear one for school, but I never saw the point of it. What is a tie? I mean, what does a tie say? Except this man is wearing a tie. That's what it says. But I mean, it has no practical purpose. You know, if it ever did have, it's been forgotten. It just seems the strangest thing. Bow tie, on the other hand. I suppose about the same rationale, it's even more useful. I just prefer him. I like him more. There's something. I think it's because when I was a kid, I studied ballroom dancing. I never let that one slip until this very moment. Yeah, I did. And when I was 7, 8 years old, I used to go to this ballroom club. The first time I ever, like anyone ever gave me a certificate for anything, or a little medal or a badge for anything, was ballroom dancing. How about that? You never knew that. That'll be on Twitter in 10 minutes time.
Absolutely.
My favorite monster when I was a kid was the Yeti.
Oh, for Doctor.
Yeah. Yeah, and I was terrified. I was that kid, I was that 8-year-old kid that was shitting myself. And you know, I haven't seen it for years, but like something used to happen like that. Something used to open on the chest and this ball, this sphere, silver thing used to come out and hover in the air. It was terrifying. Yep. Why am I telling you that? You know this stuff. You've all got PhD level knowledge, of course.
Right.
I was just wondering, out of your entire career, what do you think your favorite role is to play, and what do you think was the hardest role that you played?
The favorite role that I ever played? What would that be? You know what, I was in this really, I thought, superb Charles Dickens adaptation in the 90s of Our Mutual Friend. Has anyone ever seen it? Fantastic. I mean, you know, it almost defines the BBC, BBC drama. You know, BBC, that's what they should be doing. They should be, I mean, chiefly, that's what they're there for. They're there to do, you know, proper adaptations of old novels. That's what I think. And they shouldn't meddle with anything else. But this was a particularly good one. And there was a role. I played a role called Rayburn, Eugene Rayburn. And it was Dickens's last completed novel. He tried to finish Edwin Drood, which was his next book, but he died in the process. So this was his last completed novel. And this particular character, he admitted before he died, was the nearest thing that he'd ever committed in literature to himself. Anyway, it's interesting. I read the book, it's a fantastic book. But this role was this, I was going to say venal lawyer, but it's almost a tautology, though, isn't it? Waste of breath. But he was one of those anti-heroes in an age before anti-heroes. Nobody wrote anti-heroes. And you didn't know, as an audience, you never knew whether to kind of root for the guy or, you know, you thought at the beginning, you thought, what a twat, he's horrible, this guy. But then he becomes the, and because he appears to, there's a young woman in who's the central character in the book, and he sort of preys on her because he can. But anyway, it turns into this love story. I don't want to spoil it for you, but it's a great, great role to play. Because it was one of those roles, it's the kind of thing that I really enjoy as an actor. The kind of role, you don't have to give it away, you can sit back and allow it to happen. You know, you don't telegraph it. Anyway, that was it, Eugene Rayburn. What was the second part of the question?
What was the hardest part, like what was
the hardest role?
Yeah.
Well, any role, I've often struggled. You know, either you struggle technically to do things, and I've done that a lot, you know, but fortunately they tend to be in dogs of films that never get released. Fortunately for us. No, I've struggled a fair bit. Sometimes, you know, acting is like everything else. Sometimes, you know, you get things which suit you. It's nice to stretch yourself at some time, you know, some opportunities. But there's been times when I thought, why am I trying to do this one? A bit like the doctor when he asked me, I thought, I can't do that. That's too much of a stretch. I don't do like eccentric comedy. That's not what I do, you know. But he said, that's not what we want, you know, with the doctor. This was going to be the shift, you know, that the doctor was going to come back as a, well, look at Eccleston. You know, that's almost a definition of a non-comic. He's not a comic actor at all. But what a fantastic doctor he was, you know.
Absolutely.
And a deeply serious man as well, Chris. But it worked, you know. So Siegel was right in the end, and I was wrong.
Absolutely. Right here.
I think the salient feature was, and when I first met with Phil Siegel and we talked about it and him and the character, was the outsiderish nature of it. Seems almost pat now to, particularly to be in a room full of Doctor Who fans, but it's always worth remembering, you know, what he is, what the character is, when I first sat and talked about it, I read back, and he showed me. He gave me that thing, the Bible. You know, they had a Bible. I still have it. This leather-bound thing. He said, "Take that home and read it. Don't even talk to me before you've read this." You know? And it was this fantastic compendium of things. You know, this all this knowledge Because, you know, although I saw Doctor Who as a kid, I was never a fan, say, steeped in the heritage of not like, say, David Tennant was. No, really, I wasn't, we saw him, we watched them all, but so I didn't know, so he was able to fill the gaps in, and he gave me this stuff to read. And I thought, well, wow, what a character, and I wanted to know, why did he leave his home planet? What was this family history? What was this stuff? I said, what is he, on the run? And Siegel said, well, yeah, in a way he is, he's left home, he can't go back, So there was this kind of thing, he was almost fugitive. But there was a loneliness that went with it, which appealed to me. At the time, I'd just read as everybody had just read 28 years ago, the Anne Rice book, Interview with the Vampire, before they made the picture. But it was almost, there were certain characteristics which chimed with the Louis character in that book. Well, there were in the sense that you there's a loneliness and a melancholy that goes with, eternal life, say, in Louis's case, and the kind of the journey that the Doctor is on, all that kind of stuff. This is what I liked about it. And I was the kind of actor that came from that angle, was interested in that side of things, the sadness of it, before anything else, And then the rest just plays, the heart of it just plays, the connections that he makes, the kindness that's crucial with him. There you go. That's what I thought, anyway. But then again, you took, if Tennant was here or one of the others, you'd hear a completely different take, and that's how it should be. As Moffat says, one man, multiple faces, there we are.
Yes, right.
Did that make any sense? I feel like I'm still coming through immigration and having to lie through my teeth. Oh yeah, I'm just going to visit friends, yeah. In the audios? The hardest part? In what sense? What?
From the storylines.
What I like about the audios, I suppose, generally speaking, is what would appeal to somebody that really has read all the novels, say. And again, it's something worth remembering, that these are almost alternative histories. And that wasn't impressed on me until I'd really got into Doctor Who, having worked on it after 96, was that, you can read the books. I'm jet lagged. What's your man's name who ran it before Moffat? Russell T. Davis. I remember reading an article by Russell T. and he was saying, and he was all for the novels, and he was for the difference in the books. And he said, don't worry about, you might get a different timeline, you might get a different version of the time, or it doesn't matter, that's what it's meant to be, And I see the audios as the same. It treads that line in the narratives that can be sometimes contentious. I quite like that. But as for hard, I'm not sure. I don't know that any of it's hard. Not hard to grasp, anyway. Although I still have, I'm an Ari. Not an Ari Beast. What is it? A Johnny Come Lately. I've only been here 20 years in this mythology, so I'm still playing serious catch up. Sometimes and even at shows like this, sometimes I really need things explained to me, how things fit in with things from the different facets of the story, with stuff from the 60s. Sometimes it goes over my head. And yes, I can meet a 12-year-old kid with like PhD level knowledge. We were doing a show, where was it? It could have been in, it was recently, I think it was Houston. And we were doing one of these panels. And someone asked me a question from the floor, and I said, you know what? I don't know that. I don't know the answer to that. And this young woman said, why are you here? Yeah, and the reaction in the room is the same as the reaction just now. And then everyone went, oh, wow. But she meant it. She was like deeply serious. Like, why are you here?
Yes, right here.
First of all, I just wanted to say that we were in the States. We were really honored that about a year before all the planning was going on for the 50th, they sent a survey out to fans and said, who do you want to see in this show? And we asked for you. So we were so grateful that we got to see you, even in that little bit that we got to see you in.
That's really nice. Also, there was a petition, wasn't there? A petition raised. I know. I didn't know that because I signed it. Yeah, I signed it. I don't know, but it's the same here. We got a system in Britain. It's a kind of quasi-political. We are constitutional. We don't have a written constitution there, but they make ours up as we go along. But there's a system of present, which is about 3 years old, where if you can get 100,000 signatures on something, they have to talk about it in the House of Commons. So, and it can be delivered to 10 Downing Street. So I think this is the ruse. They're trying to get 100,000 names on their signature and take it to the Prime Minister. They get McGann back. And we got it. It's got to happen.
So my question for you, is there a historical figure that you have always wanted to play?
A historical figure? It's usually the last one I just read about. You know, I'm a history nut. My girlfriend just thinks I'm crazy. Like 3 a.m, she goes, why are you reading about this particular dictator? Like, at 3 a.m, you could be reading nice things. I just read this book about Stalin. It's just fantastic. I mean, not Stalin. Case in point, right? Case in point. But I'm fascinated, presently fascinated by this whole pre-revolutionary era. There's this wonderful book, and someone may have read it, by a historian called Montefiore, about the young Stalin from the mid 2005. This book came out. You read this book? It's fantastic. You put your hand up. No, but anyway, no, I don't want to play him particularly. I don't think anybody should. But there's certain characters from that period, definitely, yeah. Like there's like little forks in the road. Like when Stalin took control, quickly took control after the revolution in the next few years. And the Bolshevik revolution could have gone two ways. It could have gone a mild, there was a mild version, which didn't involve murdering millions of people, led by a man called Kamenev. So maybe him. Kamenev, there we are, that's my answer today.
So, speaking of history, yeah. Any chance that we're going to get another Hornblower movie?
Wouldn't that be nice? The problem with the Hornblowers is we can't get that boy home. Ewan Griffin. He's got famous in Los Angeles and he won't come home. It's 12 years since we shot the last episode. And we ain't getting any younger as well. You know, I tell you, if there's ever a revival, we'll all be like these grey-haired old fellas. Maybe they should make a virtue of that. Maybe we should shoot one where there's all these like 75-year-old Jerry.
The five-ish Hornblowers?
Yeah. 75-ish Hornblowers, yeah. Now, I'd love to do some. There were two novels that we never shot. And one in particular, this character that I played, Bush, Lieutenant Bush, he gets married in it. And he loses his leg. And the two weren't connected, but in the same episode. And I just thought, as an actor, you want to drag yourself up the aisle to get married, don't you? But your leg shot off. And but we can't get him home. It's a real shame. It's a real shame. But we better get him home quick, you know.
Absolutely. Right here.
So with the Night of the Doctor, I remember you mentioning a couple of your companions. So would that make, you know, some of the stuff from the audio dramas canon within the show now?
Yeah, you're talking about the end of the Night of the Doctor before he drinks the drink.
Yeah, say Tamsin.
He mentions
Carys,
the
Molly.
Carys.
Yeah.
So
would that make some of that stuff canon?
You know, I didn't even. Although I must have heard the word canon, used as an expression, it was kind of lost on me until last year, until that happened.
Yeah.
And when Moffat, we shot that thing real quick, Night of the Doctor, that was just a day and a half. And for the most part, I think Moffat was writing it as we went along. Because I remember, he was certainly handing me bits of paper. Yes, say this. And so we'd shoot pretty quickly. And I know it wasn't until I got, and that thing was kind of impromptu, or at least he thought about it on the day, to include these names. So I remember, because I was having to learn a list of the names, you know, I'm not a great line learner, you know, I need to, my memory ain't great. So I just remember sitting there learning these names in 10 minutes and then in the sequence. But it wasn't until I got home, back home after the shoot, I think that the kind of import of it hit me. I said, oh, hang on a second. Does that mean now that...
Charlie
and those guys, now are they part of it? Are they canon? Of course, which is right. And it wasn't until it came out that people began to say that. Now, that was his idea. It wasn't my idea. But I think as well that it was... But the good thing about that is it also partly describes the growing relationship between Cardiff and Big Finish. There's always been a good relationship between them. And Moffat, of course, let's not forget, you know, he wrote some books at the beginning, used to work with Big Finish. And I think particularly in the last 10 years, they've swapped a lot of intelligence. Of course, they swap personnel. Nick is the voice of the Daleks, there's now, they're thick as thieves now. Those two organizations, and I think that was as much a part of that, Moffat's choice to use those. But it was a good idea, I thought, because it also brought the Eighth Doctor even more and more, almost literally center stage. Now, only 2 years ago, be at events like this and I'd sign pictures, and there was, particularly if there were multi-doctor pictures, you'd see tenants or whatever. The Eighth Doctor would often be in the background, hiding in a little sort of cloud, like the way they used to, if you missed your school photograph, they'd include you later, like in a little bubble. And now this picture, I've signed one this morning, like he's right in the front. He's right in the front, and Tennant's behind him. So, so things have changed. I sound like Stalin now, don't I? Things have changed. One of the favourites of audios. I've got a few favourites for varying reasons. One of the ones we started with, I think it was the first or the second one, was this Douglas Adams script, Shada, which I know had been an episode, or was it an abortive episode back in the 70s?
I think it was abortive.
Yeah, they never got to do it, so we got to do Shada. I met my partner on it as well, Susie, who's here today. So I've got to say that. That was one of my favourites. Zagreus, I loved. And once we'd been doing them a few years, they'd say to me, "Well, which era do you want to go back to?" kind of thing. When we do them next, I said, "Well, being as old as I am, I said, well, what about something in the glam rock era? So we could do it. There was the glam. So it's things like that. Yeah, I got my own little favourites. But certainly the Five Doctors one, the Light at the End, I thought was great. I loved doing that. And these Dark Eyes ones that we're doing now, I think, are probably the best ones we ever did. We get better at doing them. The more practice we get. And also, it's the only, I'm fond of saying this, but it's the truth. The Big Finish has only one business model. That is, the more that you guys buy, the more we can make. And the good thing is now, I think particularly since the 50th anniversary, last year and this year, the pennies dropped, particularly in North America, I think, about the audios, in that it's really picked up. People are realizing, just how good they are. They're buying more and more, so we can make more and more. So it's a good thing.
I want to say Let at the End was probably better than
50th
special itself.
Yeah, I've heard that before, yeah. Yeah. Again, it had the spirit, And that's how it should be.
Hello.
Yeah.
Because he distinctly feels it's romantic, and I disagree, because I have the right to do that. And I was wondering about your position on that, and whether you feel that the Doctor maybe has romantic relationships with his companions, or is it strictly personal?
Well, I think, does the Doctor, I don't know, did you hear the question, everyone? Does the Doctor, it's about the idea that the Doctor may or may not have romantic relationships with his companions. Personally, I don't see it. I don't. But then, romance is in the eye of the beholder. Or displays of romance, anyway. I loved it that Peter Capaldi's Doctor said to, "I ain't your boyfriend." And I think that's right, because I think it's a good point to make. It appeared to this viewer anyway, particularly with Matt Smith and Tennant, it kind of strayed into that possibility, didn't it, for a while, for one reason or another. And while it should remain a possibility, I don't know, personally, as you're asking me, I don't think you can stay in that too long. I don't think it's worth it. Because I don't think he can't promise anything. He certainly can't promise commitment. You know what I mean? To use the modern parlance. So what would be the point? But of course, he's a hugely romantic figure. And those relationships, you know, whether they're on film or on audio or anything, you know, the companion is, it's a bit like, they're so beautifully written. And when that relationship is so priceless, that of course there is a romantic element, you know, in a fellow traveller. But it depends how far you want to take it, you know. But no, there shouldn't be romantic relations, you know, because I just think that's a line you shouldn't cross. I think it would ruin the story, but the possibility of it, I think, should always hang in the air. There, that's called classic fence sitting.
Right back here.
So, just going on your thing, I was going to ask and actually add to the other question. Do you think that depending on the Doctor's incarnation, do you think that would also vary on his sexuality and sexual preferences with companions? If he was into them, I mean, like, do you think... sorry, it's a really complicated question.
But I just want to make sure everyone hears it. So do I... The idea that different incarnations of the Doctor might incur or mean different facets of his sexuality or...
Yeah, like asexual,
very sexual, gay, bisexual.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a really odd question, but it's been a huge thing of debate on the internet, so I thought I'd pose it just for the heck of it.
I'm glad that, of course, it's an interesting question. But imagine being Moffat, who had to write it.
I would pity the writers.
Yeah, it'd be a tough one to write. Personally, as you asked me the question, I don't think it's the most important thing.
I don't think it's the most important thing.
It's not about Doctor Who. Is not about sexual politics.
Right.
I happen to also be one of those people that thought. I thought they missed a trick by not casting a woman. Because there are female Time Lords.
Yeah.
You know, so. But that said, I don't think it's important. I don't think that's not what the stories are about. It's about that we were describing before. You know, it's about this journey of this person, and the relationship with his companions is not a sexual one.
Yeah.
Until it becomes that, I don't think it's even that interesting.
Piggyback off of that, in the Ultimate Doctor, they said very briefly, and I know you've probably said more about this, so I just want to hear more about this. You were the first pretty doctor. That is. Well, I mean, Davison, sure, but still, like, you were like the first like really funky.
Just keep talking. I'm going to turn the mic off. You just.
But it's a precedence for, you know, doctors to kind of also feed to that demographic. So my question to you is, how have you seen the fandom change from not focusing on that to now kind of considering that, and then now you see Capaldi, which is my favorite personally now. But it's how have you seen the fandom kind of react to that?
Well, what we've seen. I think also it spanned the era of social networking and instant offense and opinion and anyway. So we hear more now about this kind of thing. I wasn't surprised when it came back in the 2000s that they may have chosen good-looking people. Smith is. I think Matt Smith looks fantastic. He looks like, I mean, he's like David Bowie in The Man Who Fell to Earth. He's a conceivable alien. That's, you know, that's proper. To me, that's priceless. Fantastic looking. The Tennant's obviously a beautiful looking man. Eccleston, why are we talking about this? But he'd kill me if he heard me talking about this. Well, I think probably it's it reflects as much about the era. I guess back in the 60s, you look at pictures, films from the 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s, and it didn't matter so much. You look at the movie stars in that period, male and female. Often, they probably had more interesting looks than super good-looking, symmetrical-looking that you tend to get host of these days. I would say that because I'm an old actor now. But you know what I mean? It's my opinion, you know, that, you know, actors looked more interesting in those days. And probably, you know, so those early incarnations of the Doctor, they were interesting looking people. Mind you, you know, Colin Baker, he's not in the room, is he? No. He was a looker. He was a handsome man. He was a handsome man. He had a beautiful look. Yeah, come on. Anyway, we could talk for hours about it. I just think it is what it is. They know what they're doing. And Capaldi, that was deliberate, you know, to cast somebody like Peter, who, again, is wonderful looking, but that ain't no male model. You know what I mean? You know, he's great looking. I'm like you. I think he's going to be the best of the Doctors. He's my favorite.
Right here.
Is there an actor or an actress you would like to see play the Doctor someday? And what do you think they bring to the role? What kind of
action
would they be?
Well, when talking before about the idea of a female, say, you know, casting a female to play, you know, can you imagine Tilda Swinton as the Doctor?
Oh,
can you imagine someone like Tilda? I mean, that's perfection, isn't it? In its way. Well, imagine what you get everything. You get everything that all the men that have ever played it have ever brought to it, I think. And something else. And mystery. You know, she's a great actor. She looks fantastic. So something like that. I'm not going to get a better answer than that.
No.
Good morning. What's your friend's name? Lindsay. Come up here, Lindsay. Only because I'm too lazy to come back here. Is it actually today? It's today, your birthday.
It's tomorrow.
It's tomorrow. Yeah. Give me a hug. And then come and see. Come and see life from this angle. See what it looks like. So what are you going to do? You're going to have a party tonight? Is it going to be tonight?
Yeah.
Oh, have a ball. But keep the noise down, right? Because we're all jet-lagged.
Thank you so much.
Oh, what a pleasure. How old will you be, by the way? Or is that at least 25? What a fine age for a woman, 25. 25 is the beginning of wisdom. Have a wonderful time.
Thank you.
There. Well, if, as I said to you before, you know, Big Finish has no other function, has no other way of functioning, other than, you know, we can only make in accordance with, you know, what you guys consume. So, yeah, any illegal downloads, we're going to just eat into that advantage and ruin it for everybody else. Yeah. Well, I've got to say that. I just think it's a bit scabby, isn't it? To do that kind of thing. I wouldn't do it. That's all I got to say about it.
Back here in the back in the red.
Well, welcome to the family. You're among friends here. This, the doctor, well, I don't know how much you know or don't know, but the eighth doctor, the one I played, has lived mostly on these audios. I've appeared in two TV dramas, one a full-length pilot, you know, 90-minute thing, and a six, seven-minute long thing last year, but that's it, for the most part. Yeah, it's all been on audio. But yeah, but it's given me a taste for it, let me tell you. I wouldn't mind coming back. That's why I signed the 100,000 petition. To try and persuade Moffat to do it. But of course now we got Capaldi, we got a new doctor, so he's going to need a, I mean, even with the best will in the world, he's going to need a clear run of at least a couple of years, I think, before we see anything. But you know what? You never know with Doctor Who. You know, there might be some way of some little red button thing. You know, like the Night of the Doctor, that was a complete surprise that you could even do it. So, fingers crossed, I'd love to come back and do some more, you know. Because, you know, the coat fitted, the shoes fitted. when I got back in it, and it still worked. I think as well, the good thing was, having done all the, in the interim, having done all the audios, I still knew what I was doing. I think without the advantage of the audio adventures in those years, I might have struggled considering that we only had a day to shoot that thing. But no, it was great. You know, it was just like, it was like falling off a bike. Isn't that the expression?
There you go.
Right
over here.
Is there ever an idea that you have for a Doctor Who episode, or an idea for a series that you wanted to start?
In the audios, like I said, I was suggesting before. Each, before they get the writers on to write the next three or four episodes, I know we're doing it now, we're at that point now in the year, they'll say to me, any particular period, anything, you know, like last year I remember saying, idly, I think we were sitting drinking a beer, you know, and I said, you know what, I'd love to, I was reading about Scott Fitzgerald, and I thought, you know, that man died without knowing. You know, but that the Gatsby was going to be a success, and just how great he was, and I just want to, wouldn't it be good, I'd love to go back and just give the guy a hug and just say it's going to be okay kind of thing. And I could see the cogs whirring in these, with these writers, you know, so maybe we'll see an episode where, I don't know yet, but maybe we'll see an episode, you know, where I can go back to 40s Hollywood, you know, and there's Scott Fitzgerald. It's that kind of thing. Usually I make some idle suggestion and it's an episode the year later. But yeah. Yeah. Withnail and I, yeah. Withnail and I was a funny story. That was like, Withnail and I. I just remember, for the most part, we went. Withnail and I, we shot it in mid-80s, 86. And at that point, Richard E. Grant had been in England, as I recall, for about 2 years. He's from South Africa. And I mean, his default state is paranoid anyway, but he was convinced that immigration and the authorities in England were going to send him home. And there was, you know, he's one of those people that he always thinks there's been it's been a mistake. You know, there was always a hand about to come on his shoulder and go, sorry, we've made a mistake. It wasn't you, it was somebody else, you know, and take him away. And when we were shooting with Nell and I, he was convinced that somehow it was all just going to fold, and he was going to end up in a police cell somewhere and get deported. And there was a morning, we were in this car. Because you've seen the picture, right? You've seen the film. The sequence where it's a fantastic drunk act as well that he does. But it's the sequence where they're leaving London for the first time in that car. He's got a bottle of whiskey between his knees and he's shouting out the window to those girls. And it was 8 a.m. on a Sunday morning, we're shooting in London, without permission. And we're dressed in this 60s hippie gear in this old car, you know, without a license plate and that kind of thing. And in order to shoot this drive past outside this apartment block, you know, he was driving, had to do this circuit of sort of half a mile because it was a one-way system. And at the apex on one of these circuits, we stopped at this red light. It was Sunday morning, quiet. And across the way, at the diagonal, was a police car, also stopped. And one of the guys was nursing a coffee, and his friend was reading a newspaper. There was nothing happening. And I saw the guy look up from his newspaper across to where we'd stopped, and then look again. And I could see him quietly nudge his friend. And then I could see his friend mouth, "What the f-?" And then turn the key in the thing, and by this time, the light's still on red, and I'm thinking, I'll never, ever get a chance to do this again. And so I stood on the gas of this car, and we took off through this red light, and now they're chasing us. And I'm trying to make it back to where this film crew, I know this film crew is assembled underneath this awning outside this apartment block, and safety. And but now I've got this man next to me, Grant, screaming. These are the cops that are now going to arrest him and take him back and put him in a cell and send him back to Africa. And we made it, just. And I remember thinking, whatever. And I mounted the pavement just for a flourish of this car, of this, and onto the pavement anyway. And there's the film crew. And there, now is the cops, you know. And I could go on and tell you the story. But before I'd even got this car onto this pavement, the passenger door was open. Grant was out, and he'd gone. 10 minutes to find him. This is all true. It took 10 minutes to find him. We found him eventually, once the cops had realised what we were doing. And they found him in somebody's garden. Hid down behind a hedge, you know, like trembling. You'd have to be there.
Yes, right here.
Yeah. So when we go on tour with, yeah, it's joyous. It's great. Like some old boy band. It's really cool. And the first time we were invited down to Australia and New Zealand, that was great. You know, it was the first time we were all together down there, four of us. And it was cool. You know, you'd be on TV, and it's nice, a little bit of glory. You know, it's nice. It's good that. And they're really good at it. You know, those guys, I mean, I've been doing this kind of thing for 4 or 5 years now. You know, I'm getting better at it. But those guys have been doing it for years, so it's nice and easy, you know, for them. But it's fun. And the good thing about it, you know, you meet Collins here today, they're lovely people. You know, they're just... this kind of thing to us is a blast. And it's not work, although sometimes it can be, but you're a bit jet-lagged and it's, you don't quite know where you are. But I know Colin would say the same. To get to meet the fans of the people that, you know, you work for, you make things for, is a privilege. And it's not something, actually, that ordinarily you would ever get to do. If we work in the theatre, you can meet people in the bar afterwards, you know. And that's instantaneous. But if you make pictures or you do TV, usually it's been a year after you shot the thing before it comes out, or you're onto your next thing. You never get to meet the people that that like it. But so that's what the joy of this kind of thing is for us, is that we get to talk to you people. We don't make it for us, we make it for you. So, and it's great to always get feedback and talk about things and talk about the work. Yeah. So,
right here? Yes, please.
What is your favorite part of filming Luther? Like, you know, how it's a grungy cop show.
My favorite part of filming Luther? I suppose. Actually, I'll start with the question. What happened to him? what happened to my guy? Isn't that? Where is he? He walked out of the door one day. What, is he going for the milk or something? Never came, but he's not dead, is he? I know they've made like two series since, and they've made a movie, but the phone hasn't rung. He's not, you know, what happened to him? I wish. My favorite bit? I suppose, the ludicrous idea of being Idris Elba's love rival. Right? Have you ever met Idris Elba? Have you ever seen Idris Elba? I mean, the idea of it, I just laughed. Again, I just thought, what? You know, they sent that to me, you know. Anyway, Idris is very, Idris is a god, you know. He's about the size of this thing here. Tense, kind of beautiful. And he gets in the mood, Idris, you know. He's a friend, Idris, and we share an agent. The agent sometimes calls me, she says, have you seen Idris? I go, what? Well, am I my brother's keeper, kind of? And she said, well, if you do see him, tell him to go to bed. Kind of thing. It's his time, right? It's Idris's time. He's staying up. He ain't going to go to bed while there's a party on, you know. This is his time. But he, great actor, incidentally, but he likes to get in the mood, Idris, for whatever it is that he's got to do. And there was a scene in that... remember the scene where we have a fight? You fight Idris Elba. And talk about a mismatch. But he... and on that day we shot that sequence, he arrived in the mood, as is usual. He wanted to beat the shit out of me. And I knew that because I could hear him get out of his car, the car that brought him onto the set. And he started to shout my name, not my character's name. So I had to hide. God, did he shot the thing like an hour and a half? Till yeah. That's what he's like. Fearsome. Yeah.
Right. Okay, I have another question for you. Would you want to be in Pacific Rim 2 with Idris or in an upcoming episode of Sherlock?
Would I want to be in Pacific Rim 2 with Idris or in Sherlock? That's a tough one, isn't it? Can't I do both? Can't I do a day on Idris's film? Play his love rival? And then get out of there before he beats the shit out of me. And then go on to Sherlock. Yeah, I'd like to be in Sherlock. I'd like to be in Sherlock. I don't quite know what I'd do. You know, I'll tell you something. I can say it now, because it's probably out there somewhere else. Initially, Richard E. Grant and me were sent those scripts. Yeah, the first approach, as far as I know, I could be wrong. Moffat could tell you that, but they sent those. They ran that by us, me and Richard. How about that? That would have been slightly different, wouldn't it? Richard E. Grant, yeah, and me as Watson. That would have been. Yeah, can you imagine? Seriously. Yeah.
So speaking of Sherlock and whatnot, I think I read that you don't watch the telly at all, except for sports.
I don't keep a television.
Wow.
Actually, we just got one because we moved into a new place. Yeah, aside from sports, I don't. No, not a lot of television.
So you don't watch your...
I'm a Liverpool supporter. Yeah. Born and raised.
I think the term is bollocks. Manchester United.
Yeah, we play them tomorrow. That's tomorrow, you know.
I got a feeling what the outcome is going to be, unfortunately.
Yeah, so I'm right. Colin Baker's a Man United supporter.
Go Chelsea.
Chelsea's a good side. No, TV, I never did watch a lot of TV. I read a lot of books, and you know what it is with me? I can't keep still long enough to watch. I kind of, if you go to the movies and you put yourself there and you pay for the thing, for the whole experience, and that's different, you know, and you know it's going to end. That's right. You know it's going to end. Whereas with TV, if I sit down in front of a television set, then I always, part of me, there's like a primal fear that that's the last thing I'll ever do. Like, it's never going to end. You know, there's something, I don't like it. I kind of resent the energy. I always think I should be doing something else. I'm one of those people.
So, and because I know the football match is going to end, but if I start watching a box set, can you imagine that? I just think that to me is like, I don't know, a level of hell. I remember having flu once, and my sister looked after me, and she's a box setter. She watches box sets of stuff, and she made me do it. Because she prayed on, because I couldn't move, you know. She made it. She said, "You got to watch The Wire." I'd never seen an episode of The Wire, so she made me watch all of them, and I was glad she did. You know, I was a captive audience, so that was a different matter. And you know, when you got a proper flu, it wasn't a man flu, incidentally, girls. This is the real thing, and it was like, you know, you feel like you're going to die anyway, so I thought, whatever. Before I die, I might as well watch The Wire. And I was glad I did. I was really glad I did.
So, yeah, Riker.
What's your next screen time?
My next screen thing? I can't tell you. Isn't it terrible? We can't speak of these things anymore. You know why? Because they make you sound little. And when we shot the Night of the Doctor last year, because there was a lot of hoo-ha. You can have that. About the secrecy of it. Anyway, we're living in an age of spoilers, and again, the spirit of which I don't quite get, I don't understand, I don't agree with. But such is the atmosphere now. We have to sign official secrets now every time we shoot something. It's sad. Actually, interestingly, Stephen Moffat said recently, I know this because I was sat next to him when he said it, we did a panel together. And he was of the opinion that, and he should know, incidentally, that he reckoned that episodes of TV things, dramas, particularly sci-fi things, are necessarily going to get shorter in the next 5 or 6 years. To do with, you know, there's an economic aspect to it. He said, but also, he said, because it's becoming harder and harder, almost impossible at the moment, to make a cliffhanger. You can't keep a cliffhanger. You know, because it's like different scheduling between North America and Europe and, you know, so it's like, I know you may have seen it, don't tell me the end, it's that kind of thing. How often does that happen now? And of course now you can see, and he was talking about Doctor Who specifically, but he said, you know, if you look at the original Doctor Who's in the 60s, they were 25 minutes long, some of them. And actually some of them were better for that. 50 minutes of television, which he has to make on the same budget that the BBC have only ever given him, he says it's becoming harder and harder. You can't be so impressive. It's, you know, to make 50 minutes of TV now is expensive, and there's a certain amount of filler now goes into, if you think about it, into some of the episodes, you can tell. So he thinks, you know, if they were just pruned and we had 25 minutes episodes, they'd be better, and you get more of a chance of keeping things secret. Look at what we did with 7 minutes. But look how difficult it was with that 7 minutes, keeping it under wraps. It was really hard. It wasn't hard for me, because all I had to do was not mention it. But that's the easy bit about keeping a secret. But if you just don't have to, if all it involves is not talking about it. But of course, you know, there were copies of it everywhere. There were copies on, you know, technicians had copies. There were hard drives that it sat on. And of course, it's going to get leaked, or bits of it are going to get leaked. So anyway.
Right here?
Yeah, there's been a lot of comments about Doctor Who and Star Trek crossovers. Do you think they'd ever create one, and would you be interested in doing it?
A Star Trek Doctor Who crossover? God, why would you not want to be in it? I'd do a day on it. Yeah, definitely. That'd be great.
And I think there was a young man back here in the blue. Yeah.
Physically injured? No. But that's probably because aggregately I've shot only about 6 weeks in my whole career. So I think probably if I worked at the pitch that I know Capaldi is working at, you know, for 14, 15-hour days for 9 months of the year, I think you'd probably end up getting hurt on one of those kind of schedules. But no, I got away with it. Sometimes when you're on film sets, they're often the safest places to be, you know, because you get big tough guys to do all the stunts and you get all kind of assistants to look after you. They wrap you in cotton wool, you know, a little bit too much.
And I have time for just one more question, so let's make it a good one. Is anybody that I haven't...
Are you suggesting that the ones that previously were...
No.
See, this is how wars start. It's you.
It's you.
Yeah.
We were talking about things coming up. There's Star Guys 4 coming up.
Yeah.
Do you have any news or opinions about what should be next?
About what should be next? Well, like I said before, insofar as, you know, my opinion counts for Big Finish, you know, they take it into account, you know, what I might want to do. But it's often as much of a surprise to me when the scripts arrive. It's even more of a surprise if I read them. Let me tell you, I tend not to even read them anymore. I just turn up and do them. No, I couldn't tell you really what's gonna happen, except I know we're doing more. We do 3 more episodes in February. That's the schedule. So, but the Dark Eyes now is over. We've done the last of the Dark Eyes. So, but I can't tell you what follows, otherwise I'll have to kidnap you.
And with that, Mr. McGann will be signing and doing photo ops in his booth. The actual picture where he's front and center as the Eighth Doctor. Let's hear it from Mr. Paul McGann.
Thank you for being so gentle with me.